Instructional Designers in Offices Drinking Coffee is brought to you by dominKnow, makers of dominKnow 1, the cloud-based authoring tool for e-learning. Learn how your team can work together better at dominKnow.com. Now, here's this week's episode.
It's Wednesday, everybody!
Out.
I think every guest now we're going to have bring in the instrumental and add something to the intro.
Our first live jam session here on Instructional.
Make them play, or at least give them kazoos.
Yeah, exactly. First time we've had live accompaniment in 5+ years of doing this. Awesome. Hey, hello to everybody in the chat. A lot of weather reports coming in. Also, as we were noting in the chat, a lot of, look at the inland. Check that out, Ben. The wheat.
That's, I love it.
Total crush on that. Wow. And we've also well represented by the Carolinas, as Pam has just pointed out. Lots of Carolina representation here with us here today. Hope everybody's having a good week so far, and we're going to have a good chat here today. Gang, this is the first time that Dr. Jane Bozarth's joining us ever on here on Idiotic. And how has it taken that long?
I don't know how that happened.
Jane, there are probably some folks who haven't met you yet or connected with you, etc. So give us the quick overview bio of yourself here.
Well, I feel sad for them. I was, I was the world's worst bureaucrat for decades for the state of North Carolina. I was a classroom trainer, and then I was an e-learning person, and then I was a social learning person. And along the way, I was a program manager for e-learning for the state for quite a few years. I worked for Health and Human Services. I worked for the Department of Justice. The last 15 was with the Central Personnel Office. So I was housed under HR, but I was in the Central Training Office. And I acquired enough months of service to get my retirement, to get my pension. And so I ran away in flames. I ran away the moment I could. It was fine. It was a great gig, but you know, no need to hang around. And I began work with the Learning Guild then. I had presented at many of their events, going back to even when Brent was there. And the director of research position had just opened up. I happened to have picked up a doctorate along the way in all those years of state service. And so it was a chance to do something very different, to use all that training I had. I wrote some books along the way on cheap and inexpensive e-learning on account of I was a state government bureaucrat. And books on using social media for training, a general ID book for just tools and tips for instructional design. And the most recent interest of mine has been making tacit more explicit, you know, learning to make our work more visible, learning to share what we were doing, that kind of thing. And that the most recent book is called Show Your Work.
Very cool.
That's what I've been up to. And I'm sorry, I'm just getting over a cold. And the minute I started talking, my nose began to itch. I apologize. If y'all just put my camera off for a minute.
Oh, it's just, we're all just hanging out drinking coffee. So it's
maybe
fine.
She's lying. Maybe her nose is growing. What did she say that's not true?
And we ought to also point out that at many conferences, et cetera, over the years, you've also organized ukulele events too.
Besides
being on the speaking stage, ukulele circles and those sorts of things too.
Yes. You know, technically, when I do those ukulele things at conferences, it's supposed to be in the context of learning. And so I pretend to do half an hour on using music as an instructional design element, not just as wallpaper. So I do that. And then we all just play the ukulele. And if we don't have enough ukuleles, then some people get kazoos, which just ratchets the chaos up to a great, perfect level.
I'm sure the feedback forms are quite interesting.
You know what? Here's the thing. The Guild usually has sponsored that for me. We've done it at DevLearn many years. And when we're done, they donate. They buy the ukuleles, and then we donate them to the Children's Hospital.
All right.
Nobody can complain. There is no – you cannot complain on evaluation. I mean, what are you going to do unless you're the Grinch, right? Best thing ever. Yay, Guild. And the Children's Hospital sends us pictures of the kids with their ukes, and it's fabulous.
Oh, that's awesome.
Super cool. I didn't know that half of the story. So that's,
yeah,
that elevates it even more. So
yeah, yeah. Guild for Good. They call it Guild for Good.
Guild for Good. Cool. And given your role with the Guild, our topic today is learning.
Guild research.
And research stuff. And research. We've got the word surprises in there in the title of the session. You guys have a recent report out. You were noting, actually, and I didn't connect, didn't realize the sheer quantity, but you guys put out basically a report every month.
I do. Yeah, that's my job. I get out a report every month. I am usually the author, not always. Sometimes I write in collaboration with others. Sometimes we have a guest. Megan Torrance is a real frequent flyer. She'll call me up just in fuego wanting to do a report. Hadida Nuruddin did one for us on storytelling. Will Tallheimer did one on evaluation strategy. So, you know, it's usually me, but not always, but it is one a month. Every now and again, we have something that lends itself more to an ebook, and we will do that. I do a gift guide every November for them, you know, a crowdsource sort of what L&D people want, which was really interesting. I wasn't here to talk about this today, but the first one I did was 2019 or so, and everybody wanted the Logitech clicker presenter thing. It was $100 and it was gold. And the next year, COVID came and nobody wanted any presentation stuff. First year had been nothing but travel and presentation, and the second year was all about how I want to make my coffee and I need warm slippers. it was really funny.
Yes. Now yeah, the gift giving changes drastically.
Everybody wanted dongles and clickers, and then none of that. The next year, none of it. Everybody was buying soda streams. So.
I am honored to actually have one of the Guild branded clickers from one of my times presenting at a Guild event. I was just thinking about that. It's in a drawer. But probably needs a new battery. COVID, right? Totally.
Yeah. You don't use a clicker to manage your live stream
at home. You don't just click. You don't have a cat or something. Yeah.
Well, it does have the red laser on it too, I think. So if I
yes, it cat, does. But...
That's always fun.
I see we got a bunch of Guild members in the chat. Hi, everybody. For those of you who are not Guild members, it's learningguild.com. Membership's free, man. And the reports I write are free, but you got to have a membership, which is free, to get the free reports. So there you go. Mostly that's so we can track you and know who you are when you get
And invite you to come and speak at an event or something.
That's right. And know how to get in touch with you.
Value add. Yep.
Yeah.
It's the and Ms. Paul Buffler's here too. Sorry, I just haven't seen you in a while, Paul. Good to see you.
Good.
Go ahead, Chris.
I was just going to say let's jump into some research goodies, nuggets.
What do we got? What do we got? So we had one surprise. People decided to change what they wanted for that particular report, but. What's do you have one in your pocket that's maybe save the best for last, but what's a good one to start with?
Let's say the most recent for last. Let's say the most recent. But because I kind of, when I first went to the Guild, you know, I was on my initial interest and my excitement that first year was grabbing hold of some of the things that had sort of become myths or urban legends in our industry. Right. And so some of the first things I did dealt with learning styles and another one with personality types. And I do try to go in with an open mind. I mean, I had my thoughts on it, but I said I need to do a fair review of the literature and see what's really there because I don't really know. I mean, I'm not really sure. And so I did a deep, deep dive into learning styles. It's a 10,000 word report. It took a long time to get together. Among the surprises there, I would say the biggest surprise, there's several things, but the biggest surprise is we don't have children. I don't have kids. I'm afraid of them, but that's a different story. I don't have kids. and I had no idea the extent to which the idea of learning styles has permeated K-12. I had no idea. Schools advertise themselves, private schools, based on that they're tailoring instruction to your child. It is almost like a belief that we all have fingerprints. It is so widely accepted and so widely understood. Parents speak it, schools speak it. I get now why it is so hard to counter it and so hard to suggest that maybe that's a little misguided. But I had no idea the amount of money. You know, generally when we talk about learning styles, those of us in workplace training, it's just a thing that we talk about. In the school systems, if a teacher gets one day of professional development a year, it is often a learning style certification. Or it's, here's an instrument you can buy, or here's something you can show the parents. I mean, the money behind this, they call it an industry. They call it the learning styles industry in the literature. I didn't know. So you two are showing big eyes when I'm talking. What are you thinking?
My wife works in the K-12 space, so I was aware of it basically more or less having its origins there and then filtering off into the rest of us in the organizational and adult world too, for sure. Yeah,
it's hard to say because since our world of instructional design, and like if we just go totally general and just talk about learning, we do have that all that crossover between, you know, academia and then the corporate, you know, adult learning side of things. And I think for the most part, I think we've all done a pretty good job of, and Will Tallheimer, I'll give a big shout out to him and all of his papers and Clark Quinn and some of the others that debunk it and have all the debunking. I think they've all worked very hard to get the corporate training side of the world to not really focus on it and to understand that it all kind of has been debunked. But since we're only kind of tangentially connected to that academic side of things and those folks, I don't think we're having much of an impact there. And it will continue to be a thing there. And I don't think there's really much we can do about it. Like you said, it's a bajillion dollar industry over there.
I had no idea, but I see people in chat are talking about why it's appealing. We cover all this. I talk about it. It is a very appealing idea. You want to hear that instruction is tailored to some need of the learner. Certainly parents need to hear that or want to hear that. There's some problems with it, apart from the obvious. Particularly when we start talking about school children. I agree with Brent. I'm not sure in the workplace business we're going to make much of a dent. It's going to matter very much. I also think it's about to get worse because ChatGPT goes and scans everything and picks up learning styles, because there's so much on it out there, and it drops it, it spreads it around again. But there were a few other things that were surprising. One of them was the conversation about the fact that it can do harm. Again, for adults, I don't know that this matters so much, but if you have a 7-year-old who gets mislabeled or stereotyped or said, well, he's just kinesthetic, when in fact he has some real learning disability or a reading deficit, you know, there is some harm. I think certainly, yes to a comment in the chat, we all have preferences. If I want to add a deck to my house, I would probably rather look at YouTube videos for that. Some people would rather go to a workshop at Lowe's. You know, that's just a preference. I don't know that I need to be making structural changes to my house just based on Jane's view of some YouTube videos. The fact that I like that doesn't necessarily mean it's the right thing. So, you know, you wouldn't have an anatomy textbook with no pictures just to accommodate some style. You don't think a kid's going to learn to swim by reading a PowerPoint deck about it. I mean, it's common sense stuff, but I understand the appeal. I do get it. But so a couple of pieces of research, of the more recent research that came up while I was working on that paper. One of them said it may not matter anyway, because teachers all say they tailor instruction to learning styles, but they don't. They aren't really. They say they are. Oh, sure. Yeah. Oh, sure. I have seen it in my world, in workplace corporate stuff, more than it's justification for decorative stuff. Like, well, we got to have dancing cats. You know, those visual people need all that entertainment. Right? The other one, though, that I thought was really interesting, and it was the most recent piece that came out right before we took my report to press. It was a 2018 piece. I want to say one of the authors was O. Houseman. I could find it if anybody wants. It's cited in the report, but they said nearly all the research is based on an instructor doing something they call an intervention. Like the instructor gave these kids an oral version, they gave these kids the visual version, right? That kind of thing. There's an intervention, there's instructional intervention. But they just ask students to say what they thought that their learning style was. And then they presented the students with an array of materials, and the students did not choose the thing they said was their preference. So maybe it doesn't matter so much. I'm a little worried about 7-year-olds getting mislabeled. But anyway, I just found, you know, the topic today is what was a surprise. And my surprise was that I had no idea the extent to which this was embedded in K-12. I had no idea. Because in my world, it had always just been, you know, stuff for instructional design, you know, e-learning design and things. But I was pretty surprised when I found out how much money was in the industry.
My first entry into our space here, when I first started working at Domino 21 years ago, I was given a formula, 20% text, 20% visuals, 20% videos, 20% audio. I think it was 5 and 20s, but anyway, a perfect ratio. And an e-learning course had to have all of these in order to support people who have different, you know, learning. I don't even know if the word styles was technically used. I was probably being thrown phrases like, well, some people are auditory learners, some people are visual kinesthetic learners, the video. And it really, it was a process on oil refining was one of my first projects. Like, oh, you want me to demonstrate that to them, what, in an auditory fashion? Like bubble, 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 bubble. Like, you know, what's the, anyway, it was not something that I ended up adhering to, although towards the end of the project, we did do a cursory to say, yes, we've covered all of these different things, but the information, you know, presents itself. You're trying to show a process. Right. Well, an animation makes sense, right? You know,
well, and it's, you know? Right. It served nobody to do it that way in the name of serving everybody. It's just Kathy Moore, though. Before we move on to something else, Kathy Moore is a wonderful human being and a great instructional design person. She, and I mentioned this in the report, I don't remember, there's a link to a free a handbook for basically for negotiation kind of conversations. And she just says, you know, you can't argue with somebody who feels they're operating from a moral imperative. You can't argue with somebody who says we're doing it for the children, right?
For the children.
You know, the children. What about the children? But, you know, she talks about how to have more productive conversations. For instance, if they say something like we need to have narration for the auditory people, the response that would be, I think that's a great idea. What if we make it so that we could turn that off for the people who are not particularly, and you know, just sort of negotiating through that way rather than having arm wrestling competitions about whether there's learning styles or not. Again, my concerns are more with the K-12 world, which is not really something I live in very much, but I think that there are challenges. The other thing that concerns me there, and then we can move on, teachers are busy, busy people. I mean, they are busy 19 hours a day, they are overwhelmed. And here they've got a mountain of promotional material touting learning styles, learning styles, learning styles, instruments, research, you know, they don't have time to sit down like Jane did and go through 700 articles, you know, going back 30 years about learning style. I mean, they believe what's they're awashed with, right? So, you know, it's a complex problem. Whether it does too much harm to adults, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm responding to Cornell in the chat about Will Tallheimer. I think just for the sake of time, since there's probably a lot more research surprises we should talk about, I'll direct everybody to just do a quick search for Will Tallheimer's work. He actually has written quite extensively about learning styles and explains all of the stuff, and I'm assuming yours does too, Jane. I don't know if you took that focus.
I'll put in a link to that too. About the issue, are there, as a matter of fact, there are 71 identified learning styles models, so pick the one you think is valid, right? There are plenty of them. The thing is, we may find out tomorrow that there is a sort of learning style framework. We haven't found it yet. We have lots of theories. There's lots of ideas. I do think we can all agree that there are preferences. I will say one of the things to look at when you go look at Will's stuff is that like 15 years ago, Will started the Learning Styles Challenge. And I think the prize is up to $6,000. $1,000 of that is James. It's mine. And for anybody that can prove, offer credible data that says teaching to learning styles has any effect on outcomes. And we have waited years and years and nobody's claimed the money. So have at it. Yeah,
it's been a long time since he started that, and
years. I want to say it's 15. I want to say it was 2006, but I could be wrong. 2006 or 8, but a thousand others of his mind. Come get it. Here's my money. Come get it.
Yep. What's the next one? What do you got?
The next one was, and again, this was early on in my time with the Guild. We probably need to go back and revisit some of these soon. It was personality type indicators.
Ooh.
And again, huge industry, lots of money. And I want to say there's nothing wrong with people making money. I mean, I don't mean to say, well, so what if they made a lot of money? There have been a good many ethical questions about a particular purveyor of a learning styles instrument. Among them, the fact that they give grants for people to use the stuff for research, provided that the research reflects the instrument in a positive light. Yeah.
Bias much?
Yeah. I think my biggest surprise there, because I had lived in a world where we have all heard of several popular personality type instruments. I'm not going to name them. I don't need to. They're two or three that are particularly well known. I was not aware of one called, depending on the acronym that day, Ocean or Canoe, which is an open source personality type instrument. And it's the acronym is Ocean, or the same letters are Canoe. And it basically looks at your openness to experience, your conscientiousness, your will to achieve, your extroversion on a scale. You know, most of the instruments are forced choice. You either are merciful or you're just. You either are extroverted or not, right? This is on a continuum. Agreeableness versus tendency to antagonism, and neuroticism versus emotional stability. It is free. It is open source. It's a five-factor model. There's no certification. There's no requirement to purchase inventories. There's no pyramid scheme. There's no delegating it down to other people. And those are traits that can actually be measured in terms of job performance to a bigger degree than something like mercy or friendliness or something. So I think my surprise there was that there was something that was considered valid, that's available, that's open source. Do you know why I'd never heard of it? I guess.
There's no marketing.
No marketing. There's nobody trying to sell it to us. Mm-hmm. You can go Google it up right now. The instrument's right there. The scoring is right there. You can go do it yourself. So,
wow,
so
there is a valid one out there.
It is valid to the extent that it's probably more, it's more valid than some of the others, partly because, again, it's on a continuum and not that forced choice. And here's the thing. Sure. You can't be both. Right. In some of the other instruments with the four stores, you can't be both things. Right. I may be merciful in one situation, but I may want justice in another. Like somebody hit my car the other day in a parking lot when I wasn't there. I want justice. I'm not merciful. I'm not really merciful. But I do think the surprise was there was something there that seems quite valid that, it, you know, if you're using it for a parlor trick, I used to facilitate some of that stuff. And it's fun for a staff retreat. It's an interesting conversation. If it doesn't get too out of hand and you don't start, you know, insisting that people can't do something because they're a certain type, or you can't possibly get along because I'm not that type. Right. So, I mean, I think it has some entertainment value. Pettinger is the famous researcher about one of them. And he says, well, it appears to measure something. So it's like, but the idea, you know, if you like it, if you want a tool, if you're looking for something, if you're getting requests to do personality typey kinds of stuff, take a look at this one, because you may not have heard much about it either. And it's just sitting there for you to use. And if you like facilitating the workshops or working with new hires and doing that kind of stuff with them, this is as good as any of the others. So maybe just take a look if you haven't already. And here they are. They're all putting their ENTPs. They're all putting their RSVPs in the TikTok for L&D. I love TikTok, by the way. I don't know why we're talking about it. I think that L&D people need to start paying a lot more attention to TikTok and quit with those 4-minute videos already. They need to knock it out, right?
We did have a great conversation a couple of years ago with I'm forgetting his name, but part of the Microsoft team who was actually using TikToks to help teach people just techniques and tricks and stuff in Microsoft products. And he was blown away by the response level to it. So it was very cool.
Yep, yeah. For sure. What else do we got? What's next on our research?
All right. This is a broader conversation. This is a bigger conversation. As much as we talk about data in this business, and I know that's been your life for a long time now, we talk about data, we talk about analytics, we talk about outcomes, we talk about benchmarking, we talk about results. I am stunned every time we do a survey. And my answer back from people about things is, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know why learning people don't know things. And one of my the favorites, because you and I worked on this years ago, particularly when I was very involved with working with social learning and social media, we would survey people about staff social media use, how are you using social media for learning? And they would tell us, we aren't allowed to use it. Our people don't like it. Our people don't like these tools. Our people. And so I would say, well, what tools do they like? I don't know. What are they doing on their own time? I don't know. What are their preferred ways of accessing tools? I don't know. I'm like, well, how can you tell me they don't like and they don't use if you don't, right? You don't know. We have had, when I asked in the more recently, we redid that survey a couple of years ago. And when I said, what are your social tools, informal use of social tools, what are their staff like? And 27% of respondents said, I don't know.
That it was a not surprise.
Depend on what tools your workforce likes. There's lots of ways you can do that. We ask, excuse me, I'm getting over a cold. I apologize. We asked, are you tying your augmented and virtual reality efforts to results? 25% said, I don't know. We asked,
maybe we should just make I don't know not an option in the
I don't know. Well, you know what? Megan is doing a survey for us now, and she sent me the draft. I wrote back. I said, I want you to add I don't know to all these questions because I think we're going to be surprised. So, you know, it takes me by surprise the number of things people said that they, you know, they don't know. And then another variation of that were the people who said, we provide all this data and the program sponsors don't know what to do with it. They ask us for it, but then when we give it to them, Brent's nodding his head. Yeah. So I am always a little bit surprised when that is the answer, given that we have access to so much information. I remember one time we had a governor, you know, I worked for the state, so we had a new governor every 4 or 8 years, depending. And they always had their pet thing. And we had one whose pet thing was workers' comp money, how much money was going out for workers' comp. And I remember I called the safety office. I was in central HR. I mean, they were just in the building across the street. I called the safety office and asked about like comparative rates of accidents across some years and see if we could tie it to any training efforts or whatever. They said I was the only person to ever ask. The only training person that ever called and wanted to know if there had been any attempt to tie the training to outcomes. Now that's hard to isolate. It's hard to say that the training is what made a difference, but they said, so I'm a little concerned and surprised when it comes up how often I hear, I don't know. I don't know. Thoughts?
Yeah. Well, me, you know, sometimes I just wonder if that's just the easy button to click if so they don't have to think too hard about it, you know, but I guess it's legit. And I guess, yeah, from a corporate perspective, I think we do. It's just from my experiences and stuff, and it always, and the reason why I'm nodding my head when you're saying all this stuff, like they don't know what to do with it, right? Like in our industry, we're really excited now that as learning and development professionals, we can collect data, right? And we can do analytics, and we've got all this stuff, and we can do XAPI, and we can get all this stuff. And all of a sudden, now we've got all this data. And to your point, people are like, so what, right? And what do we do with it next? And does the business really care now that we've got all that data and that we can connect it to the data that they have and, you know, prove this, that, or the other thing, when at the end of the day, they're like, why can't you guys just give us a class? We're asking for is a class.
But this isn't going to surprise you. What they do say is the data that the only thing anybody much wants is, did they take it? Did they take it? Did they pass it? Did they finish it? Yeah. Right. That's really all they care about. And I, you know, to your point of saying it's the easy thing to click, we don't just have it in a vacuum. I mean, we'll have a list of, for instance, what are your staff favorite tools? And we'll have a list of them, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Snapchat, you know, whatever. And they still go with, I don't know. It's not like they have a list of three. You know, they could.
Yeah,
so,
sure.
I don't know. But the thing that nags at me about that is then why are you telling me they don't like it? They won't use it. They don't do it. When in the same questionnaire, you're telling me you don't even know. I mean, you haven't, don't tell me they don't like it, right?
Yeah, so, I guess, yeah, that would be kind of the surprise. And it is a bit of a.
I think the thing they don't want to do is have to go, in addition to making classes, also go run user forums about stuff. Paul has a really good point here. I thought the business would be excited about our data. His dreams were crushed. Yes. Others of you have said that in chat too. So, I think those are different conversations. I think, yeah, we could talk all day about the fact that we have all this data and nobody seems to want it, or that I suspect this is getting us off track. I suspect sometimes we don't want to know, or we do know and we don't really want the data to show. We know that this silly compliance thing they made us do, using 20% text, 20% audio, 20% dance and cats, did not make a bit of difference to workplace injuries, right? But it's just, I don't know. I would wish people would be more curious, or I wish that they would wonder more about that. I'm always a little bit surprised when that's the answer. And they don't, and it's not, we often give people, space for an open text response if they have something more to say, or the answers are just not what they wanted. And they don't say, we don't have access to that, or we're not allowed to collect that. It's just, well, I don't know. So anyway, it's just a surprise. That's just what we're here to talk about today. Surprises. That's one of them.
Yeah. Yeah, it is good. It is good. And it's funny that, especially with things changing so much, right? Technology has changed. Oh man, like just significantly since I started in the industry way back when. And, but yet a lot stays the same. And yet not much has changed, right? And I think that's always kind of the interesting part for me, and my surprise when I see the reports and when I read through the reports, it's like, yeah, everything's changed, but yet everything is.
But it's a lot hasn't. Well, and some people are making, there's great comments in the chat, by the way. I'm not meaning
this is awesome
to ignore though, but one of the things is that the beast wants qualitative data. I was a qualitative graduate student. The beast wants quantitative data. So we do surveys and we get numbers, and occasionally we do, we always ask for text responses, and depending on what we ask, we get a lot or a little. We're talking about 1,000 responses to stuff. I will usually say, if you've got more to say, or if you can elaborate, if you would provide an email, I would like to hear more about it. And I do very often get back to those people and can do a deeper dive. And somebody in this chat said, sometimes if you just dig a little bit more, you find out they do know, or that there's something more than just they had to tick a box. I agree that sometimes that's frustrating, but we do have pretty big numbers for some of these. But I'm thinking about some people I've worked with over the years who didn't know either. They just sort of took it at face value. So We did do gift cards. The numbers of responses haven't been a huge problem. We have done gift cards. We've done contest rewards. We've done memberships or conference registration raffles. We've done that kind of thing. But when I say they say I don't know, I don't mean it's 90% of our respondents. I picked out a couple in particular, like VRAR efforts to tie to results, that a quarter of the people are working on ARVR and didn't know if the organization was trying to tie it to anything, was kind of stunning. So Peter, that hasn't been our response, but I hear you. We thought it would too. That hasn't been our result, but and the last one is our newest report. Are we ready to move on?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, let's get it tackled.
Our newest report, we did this in two parts. We have found that dropout rates are better for the surveys if we don't have them 700 questions long. So we did break this one up. It was on LMS use 6 months ago, a year ago, and then more recently we followed up with that. We had so many comments about on the theme of you need to decide your needs. You need to be specific about what you want, that we compiled them into a separate ebook. There were so many comments about that. And so we went back and took a look at the selection and the implementation processes in particular. You've decided you want an LMS, you've decided you want to talk to vendors. What are you going to do from there? And the surprises there were that, and this wasn't a huge, huge number, the surprises were the number of people who said they had no criteria. They went into the conversations with no criteria, some of the ones that did have criteria had not prioritized it. So we asked about must have, needs to have features, for instance. They didn't have a priority like that. We asked, did your criteria change after you began talking to vendors? And they said, yes. 20%, 25% said half half of them changed their criteria after they started meeting with vendors because they would find out there's a feature they didn't know about, there was a function they didn't know about. I thought that was stunning that they went in. It's great to be open-minded, but to go, I mean, it's like going to a car lot and you're all set on what you want. And the guy says, but this one has heated seats. Heated seats. Oh my gosh, we need heated seats. I live in North Carolina. We don't need heated seats here, right? we asked if they, and I had called a couple of LMS vendors. I said, we're doing this survey. What do you want to know? One of them said, ask if they're providing the vendors with use cases. 20% had not provided the LMS vendor with any use cases specific to their own work or their own business. 50% had not really given much thought to support services. They went based all on features and price. And then guess what happened in implementation? Right? Oh, we didn't. My favorite response was, we didn't think to ask about reporting.
Okay.
And now our management wants reports and we don't know how to get those and we can't get what we need. I'm like, isn't that the one thing? Is it me? I was just surprised. I don't mean to say, I sound awfully judgy and I don't mean to. I'm just like, isn't this the one thing everybody wanted their LMS to do was to report? We didn't. So it's.
Hey, we're talking surprises and that's okay. Hey,
Peter's right though. And if you're in Ottawa, you probably want heated seats. Where I am, we don't want heated seats. What we don't want in North Carolina are cars without air conditioning. I didn't even know that was a thing till I rented one in Wisconsin one day. I'm like, what? What? No air? It's like asking me if I want brakes. So that was my surprise from the LMS one. Now I will say on the good side of that, the first survey we did was some months ago. I want to say it was springish last year. The days run together, you know. Most people were pretty satisfied with their LMSs. So, you know, take that for what. I don't know if they don't want to have to go through another implementation. I don't know if they felt like they felt they made a good choice. I just found it really surprising given the scope of an LMS purchase. And the time involved in the selection and the implementation and getting the thing running and moving stuff from an old system to a new system. I was just really shocked at how scattershot it seemed to be that, well, we kind of had criteria. I asked how they were scoring things and some of them said, well, we had a score sheet, but we didn't add anything up. We didn't tabulate it or, well, we gave them pass fail, but they didn't tell me, well, okay, so how many things did they have to pass before you gave them $3 million? I don't know. I was just a little surprised.
Yeah, it begs the question, what is the problem that you're trying to solve? And if you don't know that, why are you even doing this?
It didn't feel like it. Or it felt like they kept thinking of new problems. The other thing that was, I guess I shouldn't be surprised. I work for government, but quite a few said that they did due diligence. They went through a lengthy process. And, you know, you've been through it too. It takes months sometimes to decide what you want, to meet with the vendors, to get the funding, whatever it is you're doing. And I was really, again, quite surprised at the number who said that they went through due diligence, they made a decision, then somebody upstairs just overrode it. Said, oh, well, we're not going to get that. We're going to buy the blue one. We know you all like the orange one. We like the blue one. So why did they pretend?
Yeah, you gotta jump through all the hoops to make it look like you made it a fair, process, field, whatever. It's interesting because for decades back in the early days, I find it curious the satisfaction answer to the LMS thing because it's still very. Fresh in my mind for so many years, how many people hated their LMS. I don't know if there's any data on that or if there was any research like that done way back in the day, but in the early days of them, there was not so much satisfaction.
I'm sure we could go back. They've been doing LMS surveys since we invented LMSs. And I do, you know, I think people got more savvy about what they wanted or what they needed. Somebody said, what kind of data do I think it should get? I really think that depends on your organization. I mean, seriously, there are plenty of organizations, honestly, they just want to know that you took the compliance courses. And that's a whole lot cheaper to buy and to run and to pay administrators for. I mean, I really think it depends on what you want. But you've also heard me say some of these organizations, you know, they wanted 99 reports and all they look at is still whether people completed stuff. You know, if you're not going to use it. One trend, yeah. This is getting us off topic, but one trend is people are stacking the products now. You may have an LMS, but you may also have a social platform. You may also have an, you know, some other kind of talent management system. I mean, they're layering some of the stuff to get everything they need.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, that you could consider that kind of a trend. Yeah, I mean, we've all seen that happening in the tech space, you know, yeah. For a while, all of the what do you call it? The conglomeration of it all and pulling all the different feature sets that everybody wants and needs.
Right. Well, Anonymous has said, they wrote great poetry. Anonymous said, you need to say when you don't need, but some people are backing away. I mean, it's not a huge movement, but some people have kind of decided we didn't really need this thing just to get completion reports. We could do that with sticks and dirt 50 years ago. So,
sticks and dirt is actually a learning style, isn't it?
Sorry?
Sticks and dirt, that's a learning style, isn't it?
I think indifference is a learning style. Let's go with that. I have an indifferent. I'm indifferent. Sticks and dirt, probably. I mean, we had a homemade one. It was always in danger of collapsing, but I had a homemade one. I worked, system training management system I worked with for years. It was actually, it did pretty much everything I needed, but it was very much a legacy product. The guys that built it were all aging out. And I mean, it was a matter of time before the thing didn't run anymore. But anyway.
Good stuff. Hey, are there, before we get too close to the end of our time here today, are there any new reports coming out? What are you working on? Can you tease us?
Right now I'm working on safety in training for, the guild used to be the eLearning guild and now we are the learning guild. And I'm trying really hard to keep in mind that we do have people out there who don't just do eLearning. They are classroom trainers and facilitators. And we're doing something. The new report I just sent it in actually this morning is on safety. Keeping learners safe during training. It's always been an issue for those of us who are ever involved in human services stuff. I've worked with prison guards. I've worked with psych hospital staff. I've worked with law enforcement. There are always training liabilities there. Believe it or not, there's a good many repetitive motion and back injuries that can happen during things like computer-based lab training and that sort of thing. So it's partly dealing with that, but also more heavily dealing with the things that are happening with VR. People taking falls, people taking spills, people running into furniture. The headsets can cause some people trouble. The weight of the equipment can cause some trouble. So we did a report a couple of years ago on psychological safety, which is more sort of comfort of feeling like you can speak out in your team, feeling like you can lodge a complaint, feeling like you can have an opinion and not be berated for it, that kind of thing. This is more literally about physical safety, about the ethics of putting people into really hyper-realistic situations. So it'll be out, I think, middle of May. And we have I'm hoping Mr. Thorne, Kevin Thorne is defending his dissertation as we speak. I think it's this week or last week on using comics for learning. And I'm hoping we can encapsulate some of his work later this year. He needs a break from it, but I'm hoping we can share his lit review. We have some research on, there is a new, I don't want to start a lot of fires. There's many of us are familiar with the idea of CEUs and needing to award CEUs. And there used to be a way of, they would count hours and you had to provide agendas and they would add up CEUs. There is a movement afoot to start doing that with materials and online experiences in a different way than just counting hours in a session. And there's a study, Tip Dye is doing a study about whether learners even care about such a thing. I have my own speculation about that, but we'll see. But some professions require CEUs to maintain certification and maintain your credentials or whatever. So there is talk about that being on the horizon. I'm not really sure who's pushing it. I'm waiting to see more about it. We may be due for a salary survey again this year. I don't know. We haven't quite gotten to the end of the year yet, but that's the kind of stuff in the pipeline right now. I am interested, by the way, while I've got a captive audience, I am interested in hearing what you would like research on. And what I hear mostly from people who need something they can have in hand to take down the hallway and show to a boss, show to HR and say, look, other people are using comics. Other people are using social media. Other people are saying we should not make diversity training mandatory. Other people are saying that they had no prerequisites for an LMS, and now they're saying that they didn't make a good decision. They want something that they can not just be eggheads about, but have to take to have in conversation. So I'm very interested in what people want to see that.
Which is awesome, and it's perfect timing. I think a great segue for us to close us out today. So if you could drop in where people can reach out to you and send you that type of information. And also, Tanya, if you would like to reach out to Jane and ask your question there as well, or just hit up the eLearning Guild, I'm sure you can find some answers to that as well.
I would check the Learning Solutions magazine at learningguild.com for many of the things you're asking. That would be the place to start. You might want to check our event archives and see who's talking about what and where you might get that kind of stuff, like the proposals for LMS and hybrid events, go or no go. That's an interesting question. That might be a quick flash survey. We have done a few things on hybrid work before, but I think it was a given that we were always going to be doing those. All right. Thanks, everybody, for coming. You've been a great audience. I hear my outro music. I guess I have to stop now. It's like, thank you for the Emmy. Thanks to the Academy.
Here's the hook. Yes. Folks, as always, we do have to put a shout out to Domino Learning Systems. Brent and I are both team members there, and Domino does an awful lot of work sponsoring what we get to do here for instructional designers in offices drinking coffee. I'm going to toss a little link into the chatio.
And also, don't forget to join us in our LinkedIn group.
Yes, for sure. As always, you guys have been great. Jane, this has been so much fun. Let's do some more research and get you back again for some more angles on our world.
Surprises right now, but the next time I have them, I'll let you know.
Awesome. Very cool. Thanks, everybody. Dance on out. Have a great rest of your week.